Hello everyone, we welcome you to yet another episode of The Insans. Whenever we talk of professions, we've always seen that it's a legacy that passes on from the father to the children. And as such, you'll find that an actor's child becomes an actor, a doctor's child becomes a doctor, and a cricketer's child becomes a cricketer, right? Yet, every once in a while, we come across cases where the child chooses to forge a completely different path and do something different from the parent. Today, we're going to talk to one such duo, father-son duo, that is Yash and Dilip Phadte. Yash Phadte is the rising superstar from Goa. He is the national champion for squash in the under-19 category and amongst world's top 5 players in the same. Let's hear it from Yash.
Hi, this is Yash Phadte, India number 1 under-19 squash. I'm 18 years old. I'm from Vasco, Goa. I studied in St. Joseph's High School, Vasco. My favorite cuisine is without a doubt Goan food. My favorite singer, not many people know this, but I'm a big Lorna fan. And my favorite holiday destination is Paris.
Dilip Bab, Yash, welcome to The Insans. We are so, so happy to have you today. Aap suruvat karta aayacha interview chi, Dilip Bab, tumche kalyan. Tumche cricketing career, hye koshe start zale, ani tumcha ya career baddal macha amka kide sanga.
See, aap pahili pasun cricket khelta school level, college level. And maza dhakta bhav namdev khelta. But हमें तेना पे नामदेव का टैलंट वॉज यू नो आम फाइनेंशियल कंडीशन वॉज बैड आई थॉट डेट मजे जे फाइनान्सीस मजे ये जाना हाँ सगले नामदेव हेल्प करता सो दैट ही कैन गेट दैट रिकग्निशन दैट इज हाउ ही अचीव ही स्टार्टेड गोइंग टू बॉम्बे प्लेइंग इन बॉम्बे एट लास्ट ही वॉज सिलेक्टेड टू प्ले फॉर बोर्ड प्रेसिडेंट इलेवन अंडर कपिल देव सिलेक्टेड टू प्ले इन पाकिस्तान आनी वॉट एवर आई थॉट दैट यस सेक्रिफायसीस कैन बी एटलिस्ट गोयचो तो आफ्टर दिलीप सरदेसाय तो रीच टू दैट लेवल एंड तेन्ना आमचे फायनान्शियल थिंग्स वर वेरी बॅड आनी आमी कशें करून ताका त्या स्टेजीचेर तो यू नो अचीव दॅट टार्गेट आनी त्या टायमार तो आमचें फायनान्शियल कंडिशन बॅड आसल्या कारणान आमकां ताका फुडलो जो स्कोप दिवपाचो आसलेलो ताका तो त्या टायमार ताका तो ऑफर आयलो आबुधाबीसून टू प्ले फॉर द बँक सो दे वर गिवींग गूड सॅलरी इज टू स्टे आनी तेन्ना तेन्ना ते आमी पळयलें ही सिट्युएशन हांगा सपोर्ट कोण करना सो ही ऑप्टेड फॉर दॅट जॉब At that time, I was so financially strong as well. I would have not allowed him to go to Abu Dhabi. Mm-hmm. And he started playing for that state. But magir ami chintle janna ekas ki maji gurbi jatli that my children will become sports person. Asha mhanun te to play maja asle because I wanted to play for bhav khelona jale maji gurbi tadi pude Indian khelli. Asha maje yele goiche na mir kantle asha mhanun maje intention with I am successful in that. सो आय लेफ्ट इट टू माय चिल्ड्रन की बाबा तुमचो खंयचो स्पोर्ट्स बिसायड्स एडुकेशन खंयचो स्पोर्ट्स तुमकां आवडटलो आनी त्या टायमार हांवें पळयलें हांव बीन मेंबर इन द नेवल क्लब हांव आफ्टर रिटायरमेंट आय इज टू प्ले स्कॉश इन आनी तेन्ना हांवें पळयलें एज अ टॅलंट ही ऑल्सो स्टार्टेड हिटींग द बॉल एंड दॅट इज हाव ही स्टार्टेड प्लेइंग स्कॉश इन वास्को
सो Yeah, now I think your father has explained how your introduction happened into squash. But knowing that you come from a cricketing family, what was it about squash that attracted you towards the sport? So, like what kind of gave you that thing that this is what I want to do?
I think growing up I played a lot of sports. I played table tennis, swimming, cricket. And I remember when I used to go along with my dad to the Naval Club to watch him play with his friend. Mm-hmm. I just started enjoying, you know, going in the court, you know, just throwing the ball from one corner of the court to the other. And when I held the racket, it felt right. And that time, I didn't enjoy any other sport. I just enjoyed squash. And I think after 6 months, I went and played my first national level tournament. And I ended up becoming the runner-up, which was a big thing. And I think since then, the journey started.
Okay. So Yash, before this lockdown in March began, and the pandemic hit us, you were in Birmingham for a 3-month training course. Unfortunately, because of the pandemic, the course got suspended and flights to India were also not operating. They had stopped, they had discontinued the flight. So you were stuck in Birmingham for a fair amount of time. Can you tell us something about that experience?
Yeah, I think one experience that will remain with me for my entire life, because it's something that I never experienced before. I remember, I think I reached UK the first week of March, and I started training, and after 2 weeks, all of a sudden, UK announced a lockdown. And I remember I was talking to my parents, I was talking to people to get back home. And what unfortunately is, on that very day, India shut its airports for international travel, and I was stranded in a country thousands of miles away from my parents. And luckily, I was staying with my landlord, this Scotch player from the local club, Rachel. And she really helped me. I think because of her, I sort of survived that phase. Because if I was staying in a hotel, then I probably would have been in a very bad shape, or maybe I would be still in UK, stuck somewhere. And I remember it was the beginning of the lockdown, there was a lot of food shortage. So we were, instead of 3 meals, I was forced to have 2 meals. So I think that was something I had never done before. And I was running on a strict diet, because it was a 3-month training regime, so I was given a particular diet to follow. I wasn't playing squash, but still I was forced to have 2 meals a day. Then I was told that not to go out of the house, try to stay indoors. And I think that forced me to sort of do the activities that I would not do when I'm playing squash, like sort of do gardening or listen to music, do art. And these are the things I did which I can't do when I'm playing squash. And I remember I would call my parents on video call every day, because that was the only way to communicate with my parents.
Yeah.
And I remember because my parents were so worried that their son is obviously stuck in a country thousands of miles away he's staying with a person who neither my parents know nor I'm very familiar with.
Yeah.
I only know her because of squash.
Okay.
So I remember I used to try and make sure that my parents would feel as comfortable as possible, but they obviously were very worried. But I think somehow I managed to deal with it, and I'm really grateful to everyone who supported me this time.
So of all the activities that you tried to do, because you couldn't train, because that training was not possible, is there any activity that you realized you really enjoyed doing?
Yeah, I think gardening was one activity, because I was, if not gardening, I was spending a lot of time on my mobile phone or the laptop, and which was, I was straining my eyes. And all of a sudden, she said, why don't you go out in the garden and sort of start gardening?
Okay.
And as soon as I started gardening, I realized that there's something which is giving me joy. And I always had access to it, even at home, but I never did it. And then instead of spending, normally someone would spend 1 or 2 hours in the garden, I started spending 4 or 5 hours in the garden. So I started enjoying that, and that was one activity which was the only activity I could do, and I sort of fell in love with it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So now that you're back, do you continue with gardening at home?
I'm trying my best.
Okay. And you also
mentioned about having to eat only two meals in a day, you know, because of the food shortage. So, what was that experience like? Did you really have to go hungry, or was it just like, you know, you just about managed to feel okay or satisfied?
I think I wasn't going hungry. Luckily, I wasn't going hungry because I know there were, by the time I would reach the supermarket, any supermarket, even then, you know, if the supermarket was 50 miles away or whatever, everything was empty. And I remember this one time we stood in a queue outside the supermarket for almost 2 hours. There was one social distancing, and by, as soon as people would you know, go into the supermarket, they would sort of like start panic shopping and all of that. Even though they were restricted to, you know, certain amount, these people would just keep buying. And I remember the first 1 month was really tough because people didn't know what to do. And then our area sort of got COVID cases, and it was really new at that time.
Right.
So people started panicking. We were not trying to go out because we were scared that, you know, it's a supermarket and that's one place which is sort of like a COVID hotspot. So we were, you know, looking from all angles, and we were trying that, okay, do we really need to go out, or we can sort of like, you know, make some adjustments and wait for, you know, a few days. So,
so in a way, it was a time for us to realize that we don't really need so much. You know, we can do with with less.
Yeah. And right? I think at that time I was, you know, obviously concerned about my health, but I was also concerned about the lady's health I was living with, which is, you know, about in her 50s. And I didn't want to sort of do anything that put her at risk. So
That's really very thoughtful of you. One other thing that I wanted to check with you is lockdown time and no access to gymnasiums and things like that. How did you stay fit?
I did a lot of meditation and yoga. My dad always kept telling me I should do meditation and all of that. And I think during the lockdown, I realized the power and sort of strength of art of living meditation. It's really helpful because I didn't have access to anything. Sports courts were shut, gyms were shut, and I wasn't going outside. I was just making use of the area or equipment I had at home, and using the space in the garden. And to be honest, like, doing gardening itself is you know, sort of like a physical,
very calming, soothing kind of.
Yeah, I mean, as long as I was doing something at that time, you know, I was happy, because otherwise people were just sitting in front, sitting on their bed in front of the TV. At least I was doing some activity, which was, you know.
Yeah.
Okay.
Dilipa, as a sports person, what do you believe is Yash's best quality?
Everybody likes his behavior of the field. That is very, for me also, it is very important how you give the relation of the field. That is where I like the most. And keeping a relation, talking to the people and sharing his experience, this is one of the strongest ones. And he share whatever he gains in life, he share that experience with everybody. So that is where I enjoy.
So in a sense, you find that the fact that he is totally untouched by all the success that he has achieved, that he stays humble, that he stays very grounded, and that is the quality which you find the most admirable.
And he's on his own, now traveling for last 6-7 years to Bombay on his own. Sometimes I keep a track, I travel with him, but now he's on his own. I don't have to worry about my wife or other son. Don't have to worry about, because otherwise they keep on pampering me. How you can allow him on his own to travel to US or Europe or any part of India and all that? So he's on his own. I'm happy for that. So now that is the best quality. And he share his experience. That is also
okay.
Yeah.
Yash, do you agree with your father's assessment, or you have some different idea about what you believe is your best quality?
Obviously, it's what the others think about me is, you know, at least people are not you know, don't have any negative thoughts, or you know, I'm glad that they think that you know, I have a good behavior off the court. But I think a special quality on court that the people, I think, admire about me is my fitness.
Okay.
I think the only reason being why I was able to sort of get to that high fitness level, because every Saturday, Sunday, for the last 6-7 years I used to travel to Bombay to play squash. And I would travel boost and Saturday morning flight and come back late night on Sunday. So during the week I would just play by myself or you know do fitness. So we Papa and I we just focused a lot on fitness. And you know then after doing fitness I would go implement that you know whatever I've done that week I would implement it at Bombay. So okay. I think that really helped me increase my fitness level.
So off court it's your humility and the fact that you're grounded, and on court it's your fitness levels which you believe are your strength.
See, important thing is you require a coach at this. You require when you are on the top of the world, you know, 2-3 junior is number 2 now, right in the. You require a team with you. You require physio, you require a coach, you require trainer, and all that. So, for that, you require money to hire them, and you know, all. It's difficult. So, I do all these things on my own. I do the job of a feeder, which is very good. I get about 50-100 bucks and keep on feeding him continuously, not with one. I take about 100 bucks and that much I can do and keep on feeding him any part of the court. So at the end of the day, he has to hit the ball correctly. Otherwise, with one or two balls, for match practice, we travel to Bombay because nobody knows here or whatever. But important is feeding. We have you know physical fitness in Goa, then feeding I do in Goa, and for match practice and all that we have to go to because there all the top players are based in Bombay, and now that is how we learn, and they have decided to give membership CCI and all that because now Bombay people require yes to be part of CCI now. So that is one of the reasons.
Yash, as a you know as a parent, what is the one quality that you have imbibed from your father which you believe helps you become a better sports person?
I think every quality, because I think I have looked up to him as a sportsman, even though you know he never played squash professionally, you know. I think as a sportsman, I've always looked up to him. Like in my mind, like he's sort of like a hero to me. I always look up to him in every aspect. But I know the support that he's given me, the support that my parents have provided me with, because they've never sort of thought twice before providing any financial support to me, and always given me the best. Because I remember my dad has gone to the extent of selling his own properties at one time to sort of make sure that I have you know all the facilities and all the support with me all the time. So
your it's basically the man behind your success as we see today is your father. I mean, of course, the whole parental setup, yes, your family setup, yes, but I think Dilip Patte is the man behind Yash Patte, so to speak, right?
No, sometimes what happens, I thought that at certain stage, you know, you achieve something. Now, the whole world is so competitive. At one stage, I say, thought that, yes, enough is enough. Now I have to. But then after this whole world is competitive, I said, yes, has to travel to all over the world. And what I thought about him, yes, in my mind, or this guy can achieve any target. Or now the records are there. There is no doubt about it. So then I thought that, yes, I have to go out of the way. And some adjustment as far as the financial things are concerned. And I gave him everything. So he should not feel that because of financial I could not travel, you know. Now he is on his own, he's getting sponsorship, all these things. So what I thought about him, yes, he has come to that stage. Now he cannot come down now. He has to go. Because right now he is in the world number 2 in under 19.
So, Dilip, can you tell me ki kehna tumka aashirvaad le ki Yash has the potential to become world number 1 in squash?
Yeah.
When was that time that you realized now I have to ensure that you know there is no looking back, that he has that, he has it in him.
See, when I travel abroad with him and all that, my only job is talking to the coaches of the opponent, people like Egypt, number one team, people like Australia, number two, England, and all. Whenever he played, or whenever I used to talk to the coaches saying that, this is my son, we don't have a trainer, we don't have a coach and all that. After the match, can you advise us what he has? And they were shocked, like, you know, you come here without the coach and all that, and your daddy is. So, there I thought the progress of, you know, that is how. And today, I thought that he can be number one, world number one, for simple reason. I have seen, you know, the progress of other childs and Yashi's progress. And I thought that we are very close to it, we can achieve that. Because of pandemic, little bit things are not otherwise, I thought Yash is there on the top of the world. This is what my, and I will not leave anything behind to become number one, or you know, that is how I planned. Otherwise, I would have not come forward, because I saw that talent, yes, because we have to learn, we have to go to the places, see where we stand. That is how I go to look at it.
Yash, as a person who plays competitive sports, fitness is very important, right? So, and this includes your dietary requirements as well. So, can you share with our viewers a little about what your fitness regime is and your dietary requirements are?
I think I'm lucky to be associated with Go Sports Foundation. Go Sports Foundation is a big organization that is run by Rahul Dravid, Gopi Chand and Abhinav Bindra to promote and help the top athletes in India. So they support Deepak Karmakar, PV Sandhu and you know all the top athletes. So they chose me as you know one of the top juniors in squash in India. And I think with them they don't only provide financial support, but they provide us you know help with the you know the best physiotherapist, the best nutritionist, and the best you know fitness coaches. So right now I'm associated with people like John Gloucester, who's the Indian cricket team physio, and I'm associated with Ryan Fernando, who's a leading nutritionist in India, who works with many Indian cricket team players. So right now I'm working with the best, and because of them I've finally realized the importance of you know maintaining that physical level or maintaining that new diet, and I think I've already started seeing the difference in my game, because you know now I've realized that you know all these small things make a big difference at the end. So I think I'm following like a good sort of strict diet right now, you know, a good fitness regime, and this is all you know suggested by the top and the you know, best people in the business.
So if I have to ask you what would your typical meals be like? Yeah. So for breakfast, for lunch, what would you typically have?
So I think the advantage with you know being associated with the top people is that they understand you know where I come from. You know, the person who I'm working with, like Ryan Fernando, he's basically from Goa. Mm-hmm. So he knows that you know I can't live without like you know fish or curry. You know all that is a part of my you know diet, but sort of you know the quantity is different, or maybe a little extra you know something more in that curry or you know in that fish or big proportion. So all of this is you know it's sort of normal, but you know in a way it's different.
Okay.
And you know it's yeah,
so you get to eat whatever is the normal food that
yeah.
you would eat in your
yes.
in your homes or in our own
yeah.
homes, but with a different, in a different proportion, and possibly some other additions
yes.
would be there, right?
Yes, correct.
And in terms of fitness, so what is it that you do? Daily exercise regime, kashi asal mhanje don vara karta jiman kiwa tumka run karche patta ka kire mhanje kasli exercise hai.
I think I am very lucky because I have you know lovely beaches in Goa. We have lovely beaches, you know. At our disposal, so you can just go to the beach early morning for a run and all that. I make sure that I go to you know like a Bayana beach or Bomala beach early in the morning for let's say 1 hour run, So that's how I start my day.
Okay.
And then, you know, I start playing squash after that, and then I go to the gym for, let's say, 1 or 2 hours. Then, you know, I'm doing some other activity in the evening, or doing another cycle ride, or, you know, swimming or something like that. But I make sure that I'm making the best use of the, you know, the facilities I have at the moment. Because when I'm in Goa, I'm exposed, and I have everything is available at my doorstep,
right.
Which is, you know, the case for every person living in Goa.
Yeah.
I think they should make the best use of it.
So in on an average in a day, what you spend about 5 hours on your
I think
fitness?
5-6 hours on average every day.
Okay, and when you're not doing your trainings or on your exercise and squash, what is the kind of things that you and your father do together? So this question is for both of you. So as father's son, is there any activity that you all do jointly, that you all do together?
Yeah, I think there's one hobby, like we both love fishing. That's one thing, you know, we do. And I make sure that when I'm back in Goa, I spend a lot of time with the family, because out of the 12 months, 8-10 months, I'm traveling, you know, abroad mostly. So I don't have time to give to family. So when I'm at home, I make sure I spend a lot of time with my father or my mother in that way. So.
So between the two of you, it's fishing, is it?
Yeah. And,
I always tell my other son, or to everybody, these children should learn cooking. My job, I'm cooking at home, maybe with which I like. You know. Now recently, I told him, when you travel, you know, cooking is one of the best things to happen.
Essential survival.
Very
skills.
Essential. If you know cooking, you will never have problems in life, especially girls, and they should learn cooking. And this is how I am trying to tell them, Baba, I will teach you, or you learn from mothers or grandmothers. These are very important things in Goa, children should learn from their grandmother.
So Yash, are you taking your father seriously and planning to learn cooking?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm doing my best. I did a little bit in the UK, because the lady I was staying with, she's never been to India, and she was very curious to know about, you know, she's heard of India a lot about Goa.
Right.
And there, I remember one of the days I made her a Goan fish curry.
Oh.
And you know, it wasn't the best, but you know, she enjoyed it. And you know, I remember I said, you know, you can't eat with fork and knife, you have to eat with your hands.
Oh.
So yeah, so that, and you know, that Goan fish curry, obviously it didn't have that perfect taste,
right.
But even though she really enjoyed it, and I think credit to my father that at least, you know, I know something which you know.
So you plan to pursue cooking a little bit as much as you can?
I mean, as a hobby, obviously I would love to do it. Yeah.
Okay, now moving on to a slightly more serious question. How does playing competitive sports change you as a person?
I think playing competitive sports changes, at least has changed me completely as a person. I think it's most importantly, it's taught me discipline, which is key in in general in life. So
absolutely.
I think that's one thing, you know, I have learned, and I implemented in every aspect in life. And I think that's one thing that has sort of changed me as a person. And I think that's one of the most important quality I've learned from sports.
See, competitive, when he says, I also keep a close track all over the world. Because whenever you play a top class tournament, I know his competitors. So wherever he takes things for granted, take example, he is not on time for the practice, or next day he is not doing any practice and all that. So I remember, yes, careful about your ranking. Even though 2-3 days he takes off, your ranking will come down. Because I keep a close track to UK ranking and all that. The minute he takes, you know, the other players will come. So these are things to remind him is very important. He cannot take things for granted. When you are top 5-6 in the world, you cannot take, you have to be on the toes. And I am there to remind him, look at the ladder. You will immediately come to 3 steps down if you take 3-4 days.
Yeah.
You cannot do. So he has taken that. That's why he is there. You know, you have to keep a track on your performance, and that is how I remind you.
So basically, discipline is one of the most important things that one imbibes as a sports person when you play competitive sports, and that is one thing I would truly agree that it's one of the things that can really change your life, that's discipline. You know, it was awesome chatting with the two of you, and before we let you go, there's one thing that I have to ask Yash. What are your plans for the future? So what does your future look like now? Would you like to share with our viewers or with your fans what you intend to do now in the forthcoming months or years?
Yeah, so basically because because I'm top in squash in India, it has opened other doors also. Like, I've got offers from top universities in America, like Harvard, Yale, and all those big universities. And they're not I don't have to pay anything. They're offering me 100% scholarship. So I literally fly the moment I leave home. They are paying for everything till the time I get back home. So I think that's something no one gets. And at the same time, I can I'm getting to train and play under the top coaches in the university. So I think that's something I'm really looking forward to. Because whatever decision I'll take it so that I can improve my squash in one way or the other. And I think the way of doing that is sort of moving out of the country and at least moving out of Goa, and my base will be Goa, but at least moving away from Goa at least will help me progress in squash. If I stay in Goa, it'll just go away.
Yeah. The scope.
There's absolutely I think staying in Goa, there's no facilities, nothing with sports is just zero. So I think the best way of doing that is going abroad.
And you have the option, you have the avenues which are opened up to you.
So I think I'll definitely, choose one of the options and make sure I make the best use of those.
So thank you very much, Dilba. Yash, we wish you all the very best in your endeavors. And we have absolutely no doubts that we'll see you as a world number one in squash very soon. Thank you so much for that.
Thank you for joining us today as we chatted with Yash Phadte, India's number one player in squash in the under 19 category and one of the world's top five players in the under 19 category. We hope you enjoyed today's episode. Please like, share and subscribe to our channel. And do not forget to click on the bell icon to receive future notifications. We will see you again tomorrow at 7 p.m. Until then, Mogasu.